Hello. Welcome to tonight's League of Women Voters ABC meeting. Tonight, we're going to be looking at the topic of air source heat pump technology, which is a new technology. It's really being supported by the money that came through the IRA, the Inflation Reduction Act, and it has a lot of important ways that it can help to reduce greenhouse gases. So we're going to look at that. We're going to start off with me, because I just put one of these in this year, and so we're going to talk about my experience doing this first. And then we have with us Arbor Otalora-Fadner.
Yeah. Very close.
Yeah. And he's with the Minnesota Center for Energy and the Environment, also with the Heat Pump Consortium. Mm-hmm. And so he's going to talk to us about that. I got hooked up with these guys because once I put in my heat pump, they sent me a survey to ask me all kinds of things about it. And so then I had to learn all kinds of things so I could answer their survey. And I said, if you're doing all this research, do you talk to people? And they said, yes, we do. So here he is. So that's how we got to know each other. So anyhow, if you want to start my presentation, I'll share with everybody. We put a new HVAC heating, ventilation, air conditioning unit in. We built our house in 84, so that's a typo. Our air conditioner was a 1980-93 air conditioner and a 1999 gas furnace. So we replaced both of those with a high-efficiency gas furnace and a five-stage air source heat pump. And you can see there the furnace looks like every other furnace, and the heat pump looks like a tall air conditioner. So that's pretty good. Next. We're in Conexus country. Conexus is our electrical supplier. And so when you go, when you do something like this, you know, you probably heard about all these different rebates you're going to get, right? All this money to support your purchase. So our purchase was about $18,000. Which is a big chunk to bite off. But, you know, with this aging, we'd been having problems with the furnace. We knew we had to replace it, and I wanted to be able to replace it when I chose and not when I had to. So we did this. I started about a year ago working through Conexus. And when you work through Conexus, you have to find a contractor who's registered with Conexus. And so you you go to their website and you find this little locate a registered contractor. And when you click on air source heat pumps, the next one please, you get this. You get 1,354 people that you can choose from, which is a whole lot of people. But you can click, see where it says business name, city, and zip code in blue. You can click on any of those and it will sort based on that. So this is how the list comes up right now. But I sorted on city. And I started going through all the ones in Andover, where I live, and there were, I think, six. And between the ones that didn't reply to me and the ones that I thought seemed a little, maybe not, I ended up looking in Blaine, too, and that was how I found Ideal, the people at Ideal, because they were good and they worked well with me. So in terms of rebates, so again, we spent $18,000. We right away got a CenterPoint rebate from CenterPoint Energy for the furnace because we upped our efficiency on the furnace. That was a $400 rebate. Conexus took a little longer, was a little weirder. We had some kind of a problem between the contractor and Conexus getting the form sent to them, so that it took until July to get that straightened out. And then you can see this is a copy of my August bill here. You can see that we got our member cash back of $32.27. And then we got our rebate of $630. Our basic service with Conexus is $14.50. Our regular, the amount of electricity that we use was $119 worth. I pay the extra $10 to have my power come from solar. So that's the $10 charge. I don't know why they took off $7.50. I'm not sure what that's about, but it was in my favor, so I didn't ask. And there was taxes. So that's, you know, we end up though with an amazing credit of $748. So we're not going to have to pay electric bills for quite a while now as we move on here. The next one, please. So how's this performing? This is kind of a busy looking chart, but when you go to sign in at Conexus, you are greeted with this chart. And so when you look at this, the yellow bars, the gold-colored bars that go up and down are the normal time, and the blue bars that go up and down are the cooling season. So you can see there's two cooling seasons shown on there. The first one, the first blue bar area, is the 2022 cooling season, and you can compare that to the time with the heat pump, which is the 2023 cooling season. The green jaggy line is the high temperatures, and so you can see that even though the high temperature, we had more heat in 2023 than 2022, we used less electricity. The electricity that we used in 2022 topped out in July over 40 kilowatt hours, and our max in 2023 was 35. So, you know, we've used less power. You want to hit the next one? And it's kind of fun to run. This is our thermostat. It's on the wall. I also have my phone has the app on it. And the picture there, the weekly schedule, I set up a schedule on my computer that I run the thing through most of the time because you can see the full width of it and it's easier for me. And so the little blue numbers, you see deep sleep, wake, home, evening, and there's another one too. So you have these different periods of time and you just set the temperature that you want. The blue is the cooling, the red is the heating, and you set the temperature that you want it to be. And my goal was to set it so that it never had to like go up a lot or down a lot at any time, but it would kind of vacillate. It would be warmer in the house in the daytime and cooler at night. So we've been happy with the performance of the unit, and there's nothing weird about its operation, except you had to learn how to use the thermostat, which was a little bit of a challenge for me. So how often does it run? And the other thing that this thermostat gives me is this report of how often it runs, so I can look at it by month, and this shows you the different months. It was put in April and May, so you can see we did some heating in those months. And there's stage two, stage one heat, and an auxiliary. I think that the auxiliary is our gas furnace. Now we have it set so that the gas furnace doesn't run unless the temperature's below 32, so I know that now we're not having any use of gas in our house. And then stage one and stage two cooling, I assume those are different stages of efficiency. And maybe Arbor knows and maybe he doesn't. So he can explain that if he could. The next one, this is the last one. And then you can also look at your daily record. And then you can see there that you can look day by day how you've been using it. So, and also on Conexus, when you look at that big graph, you can see your daily electric use too by hour on the Conexus graph. So you can see, you know, oh yeah, that must have been where I changed the thermostat, or you know, the kids came over or whatever. And so it kind of, there's different ways that you can do that. So now I'm done, Arbor, and it's up to you. And Arbor's gonna introduce himself and tell us about his job too.
Yeah, sure thing.
My name is Arbor Otalora-Fadner. Like I said, I am a program coordinator at Center for Energy and Environment. I'm very happy to be here talking to you all about heat pumps this evening. Now, I will admit, this was a working title I had as just a joke to myself. I kind of forgot I never actually updated. But truly, this presentation here is, what is the ado about heat pumps? Why is there all this buzz happening about heat pumps? Just as a poll of the room here, who here has heard about heat pumps before? Excellent, okay. Now, who here has heard a lot about heat pumps? All right, excellent. So we've got some good awareness about heat pumps being out there in the room. Maybe people haven't been diving around the internet and researching specific units and brands and specifications. So this is a really good spot to be. Now, what I'm going to be doing with this particular presentation is first we're going to be talking about the basics. You know, maybe this will be a little bit of repeat ground for people who've heard about heat pumps, but we want a level set of what are these things? What is this set of equipment? Now, why are people in the energy world, like myself, really excited about heat pump technology? What's going on? Why is it creating all this buzz? And also, as Gretchen teed up, why is there all these incentives that are coming out to make it more affordable for more people to be able to install these into their home? So what's the fuss about? Well, we talked a little bit about the general types of heat pumps that are out there, the different applications of how they can be installed in your house, depending on what the needs of your house are and what your particular goals are. We're going to talk about how heat pumps interact with your energy bills. And finally, we're going to do an overview of what incentives are currently available for heat pumps and what does the landscape look like in the short term and the longer term for incentives for heat pumps. If at any point you've got questions, hopefully we've got time, feel free to raise your hand, ask and would love to get any thoughts as they come to you. All right, just a tiny smidge about our program. So, like I said, Center for Energy and Environment, that's the umbrella group. We are a nonprofit that's based out of Minneapolis and St. Paul. And this is a particular program we run called the Minnesota Air Source Heat Pump Collaborative. Basically, the whole idea is that we are out there to do research on heat pump technology. And a lot of what we do is connecting with contractors, distributors, and manufacturers to try to make sure that we can make it as easy and address any barriers to heat pumps being more and more available and affordable out there for people. And one of the side things that we do also is get up in front of people and talk with homeowners who are interested in heating and cooling options for their home to talk about this high efficiency technology. Okay, why all the fuss about heat pumps? So heat pumps, as you probably heard, because it seemed like there's a good amount of exposure in the room about heat pumps do two things. They do heating and they do cooling. So in the summertime, they operate exactly like traditional air conditioners do. What they're doing is they are absorbing heat from the inside of your house, they're absorbing humidity from the inside of your house, and they transfer that heat outside and discharge it outside. So that has the effect of keeping your house nice and cool in the summertime. Now the difference with heat pump technology is they can go the other direction. In the wintertime, they can absorb heat from the outdoor air, even very cold outdoor air. They're still pulling heat from it. They move that heat inside and discharge the heat into your house to keep it warm. So cooling in the summertime, heating in the wintertime, heat pumps do it both. Now, one of the main benefits of this particular kind of technology, it is super duper energy efficient. That's one of the things that has people in the energy world really excited about this technology, is that it can do, generally speaking, more efficient cooling than standard air conditioners. We saw from Gretchen's slide that drop in how much energy she was using during the summertime months after switching to a heat pump. And during cool and cold weather, heat pumps are more energy efficient than furnaces. In mild weather, up to 3 times more energy efficient than furnaces, even high efficiency furnaces. So that's another really big deal. If we are thinking about some ways that we can decrease the total amount of energy we're using, heat pump technology is a very promising option for that. Now, heat pumps have actually been around for decades. Some of you may have run into heat pumps before. Usually they're in the, you know, in decades past, they were in kind of the milder areas, like the center of the country and the south, where they didn't need that much heating. But you wouldn't really see them when you got this far north because our need for heating is so intense up here. Now, heat pump technology has advanced a lot in the decades since those kind of early observations here. So our organization, CEE, did a bunch of field research about 7 years ago, observed cold climate heat pumps, which is a special kind of heat pump specifically designed to pull heat out of very, very cold outdoor air, specifically designed for working in cold climates. Those can deliver heat down to negative 25 degrees. So that's a big jump in the technology. You're seeing more national level field studies that are also studying how heat pumps perform in cold weather climates. You're starting to see it in Massachusetts and Michigan, and further validating these results that yes, heat pump technology is ready to provide cooling and heating in cold climates like ours. Now, why does that matter, really? So if we're getting heat from a furnace and we're getting heat from a heat pump, why does it matter what kind of equipment we're using? Now, the big thing is that it's all about how we get our energy. Now, the electric grid has some really exciting stuff going on in Minnesota. In general, across the nation, what you're seeing is that electric grids are getting greener. That is because you're seeing coal, which is the dirtiest fuel we can use to generate electricity. Coal is becoming less economically advantageous. You're starting to see more coal plants get dropped offline, and you're starting to see natural gas, which has less emissions, take its place. So you're seeing a drop in how many emissions are attributable to generate electricity. Now that's cool. And you're starting to see a huge surge in how many renewables are coming onto the grid too. Wind, solar became so much more economically possible, you know, relatively recently, so we've seen a big jump in how many renewables are on the grid. Now, Minnesota went a step further. Minnesota, we actually have legislation now. This is passed. It's called the Minnesota 100% Clean Energy Bill. Super exciting stuff. It requires electric utilities across the entire state to provide 100% carbon-free energy by 2040. That is incredible stuff. Now, what that means is that as we are using electricity rather than combusting fossil fuels, which is kind of the traditional way of powering a lot of things in our homes, we are tapping into an electric grid that is getting greener and greener. And over the lifetime of equipment, which, you know, usually HVAC, they say like 15 to 20 years or so, the greening of the grid is going to make this a really, you know, climate-friendly option for heating and cooling homes. Another advantage about heat pumps is heat pumps kind of give you the option to choose your fuel. So one of the things that we recommend is having, we kind of think of it as like a stack of options for heating your home. You've got your primary system that does most of the heating throughout the year, and you have a secondary system that only kicks on when it gets below a certain point. So when it gets really, really cold outside, that's when you have a secondary system kicks on. Gretchen, what was your furnace set to turn on at?
32.
32 degrees? Okay, great. So that's an example of all the time where you kind of have that, you know, fall weather like we're having now, springtime weather where it starts to get chilly, you start to get down to freezing. The heat pump is handling all that heating. That is all coming from electricity. As we talked about, that electric grid is just getting greener and greener over time. So that's where you really see the climate benefit of that heat pump. And when it gets below a certain point, the heat pump would need to use a lot of electricity to provide that heating, and it can be cost advantageous to switch that secondary system, the furnace. So it's called a dual fuel system. It's a bit of jargon here. You can choose what you want to do. You can use electricity, heat pump, and you can use your gas system. All right, so if that's the stuff that's cool about heat pumps, how do these things work? I use some kind of, you know, maybe ambiguous terminology, like it moves heat from one place to another, absorbs heat and moves it around. So how does that happen here? So the secret is refrigerant. This is basically an advanced air conditioner, right? Air conditioner, again, we all are comfortable. Maybe we don't know exactly how it works, but we're all comfortable with how that works. A refrigerator works the same way too. This is just kind of the next generation of that type of technology. So who here has a home that has a furnace? Okay, great. Sometimes it's a boiler crowd, it's always good to check, but for people who have furnaces, this is the kind of thing that you see when you go down your basement, right? You've got that kind of stack, you've got the furnace in the bottom, that box that have kind of a cutaway in this diagram here, that's what's called the A-coil. That's the air handler. So you've got your indoor unit, which is passing, you know, the air throughout your house, you've got refrigerant lines, and you have the outdoor units. So this is the heat pump setup. Summertime, again, we're all comfortable, familiar with it. Step one, you've got air moving through your system here. So it comes down through the return ducts, it goes up through the system. It's hot, it's humid, it's picked up all of that from the inside of your house. What happens is that the refrigerant is pressurized in a way that it absorbs that heat from that indoor air, and it moves that refrigerant that has absorbed that heat out of the house. In the meantime, the air that goes back into your house, nice and cooled down. We like that. So it pumps that refrigerant that is containing all that heat outside in that outdoor unit, discharges that into the outside air. Wintertime, it goes the opposite. So now let's start from the outside. The first thing is that outdoor unit, that condenser, is pressurizing the refrigerant in such a way that it is absorbing heat from outdoor air, even very cold outdoor air. It is absorbing that heat and packing it into the refrigerant. Now that refrigerant gets moved into the house and it warms up that coil that's inside of your ductwork. So you have a kind of mild and start cooling off air that's moving throughout your house. It runs over that warm coil, it picks up that heat and it goes and warms your house. So that's how it works. You're not moving air between the inside and outside of your house, you're doing it through refrigerant. Mm-hmm. Yep, that's right. Yep. Who here knows how well insulated their house is? Yeah, okay. So good news for people who, and you know, you may have a well insulated home, but just not even know it. That's totally possible too. Heat pumps work fantastic when the home is already weatherized. Now I live in a home that was built in 1919. It's a classic, beautiful house, I like to think, but it is leaky. I just actually noticed there's a giant crack in my front door that I could see through. I didn't notice that before in the years I've lived there, but there you go. Lots and lots of little leaks mean lots and lots of cold air gets in during the wintertime. Heat pumps deliver less intense heating than furnaces do. That's part of the reason why they're so energy efficient. But it also means it is extra important before you get a heat pump to consider, do you have decent insulation and air sealing on your house? Because that is really going to help you maximize the energy savings from your heat pump. Now, what are the types of heat pumps? So there are two kind of trees or branches of the family of heat pumps. You've got ductless heat pumps on the left, You've got ducted heat pumps on the right. So this is a furnace crowd, which means everybody here is going to be looking at the ducted heat pumps on the right. The outdoor unit you'll see on the left, it basically looks indistinguishable from an air conditioner. It just is on little risers to get it above the snow line because it's going to be operating when it gets cold outside. But otherwise, it just integrates into your ductwork in your home. It doesn't look any different from an air conditioner. So I'm just going to focus on the ducted system. I will note ductless systems can be installed anywhere. So these can be good options for cabins, places that maybe don't have ductwork. This can be good options for areas that are really difficult to condition. Maybe there's one part of the house, an addition or something, that just cannot seem to stay warm in the wintertime or stay cool in the summertime, because these can get installed virtually anywhere. So for ducted systems, of course, they need ductwork to work because they're relying on that circulated air throughout the system. They pair with a furnace. So that's how they work. They are set up on the back end, so you don't need to worry about running over and turning on your furnace when it gets to a certain point. This is set up to happen in the background where heat pump is a primary system, provides heat down to a certain temperature, and it will automatically switch over to the furnace. So they get paired together. And they can also work if you wanted to go for an all-electric style of house. We'll talk about that in a little bit. They can also work with electric resistance secondary systems. All right. Now, I like to bring this chart up here because, you know, we as Minnesotans, a lot of our identity and pride, may I even say, is built upon the fact that we have really cold winters. We have very cold winters that is important for us, that's important for us to tell other people about when they come up and visit from warmer places, that it's very, very cold here. And that is very true. However, we actually spend a lot more time in the kind of the mild to moderate temperatures than we perhaps think about, because our brains automatically go to that one time it was like negative 60 outside, you know, the water glass like froze when you're walking just down the street. We think about those times. But a lot of the year is spent in mild to moderate temperatures. 80% of the time that you need heating in the Twin Cities metro is spent above 20 degrees. And the good news is that this is where heat pumps really thrive. A heat pump is a highly efficient option to provide heating in these mild to moderate temperatures, you know, roughly speaking, when you're above 20 degrees. Now, depending on the heat pump you have, some heat pumps, you'll want to switch over to that furnace at a higher temperature. Some really advanced heat pumps can go quite low before they would need to switch over to the backup. I mentioned cold climate heat pumps before, and that's really the big label when it comes to the highest performing, most energy efficient systems out there. Cold climate heat pumps are specifically designed to pull heat out of very cold air to keep, you know, the inside of your house warm. A cold climate system can operate down to 5 degrees outside before switching to the backup. Now, if you operate down to 5 degrees, that is covering 95% of all the heating hours that you need in the entire year. That's pretty great. You still have your backup system just for when it goes below 5 degrees. But you're covering 95% of the time. You're using electricity to cover what used to be a fossil fuel appliance covering. You get really big environmental benefits from that kind of electrification. So that's really cool stuff. Now, a standard heat pump, there's lots of different options here. But if it's not a cold climate heat pump, we're just lumping them together as more of a standard heat pump. You know, you can operate it down to 35 degrees or so. And that, even 35 degrees, you're covering half of all the time that you would want heating up here in Minnesota. You're covering half of all that time with that heat pump. So that's really a big green benefit too. Now, how heat pumps can work with other heating systems. So let's do a bit of a thought exercise. So congratulations, you all now have a heat pump that works in your house and it is set to run down to 20 degrees before it switches over to that backup furnace, which means you've successfully electrified 73% of the heating. Well, I didn't update that, 80% of the heating year. That's for further north. So heat pump takes 80% of the year, good stuff. Now what do we do about the other 20%? This is where the secondary system comes in. You can either supplement or just completely take over the heating that you have in that time period. So you have a few options for considering heat pumps. Now option one is you install a heat pump which replaces your AC, but you keep your existing furnace. So one of the nice things about that is that you're lowering that upfront cost, because the more pieces of equipment you're getting installed at the same time, of course, the higher that cost is gonna be. Option two, and this sounds like the option that you want, you can install a heat pump and a new furnace at the same time here. So again, the heat pump replaces the AC system. You get your new furnace that replaces the old furnace system. And one of the advantages of this is that it's important to make sure that these two systems coordinate well with each other, right? Who here has kind of a Bluetooth speaker or anything else like that in their house? Yeah, so we like when systems work well with each other. If we're using our phone, we can click it, and it's making the Bluetooth speaker do the things we want. So that's good coordination. And one of the advantages of having a heat pump and a new furnace installed at the same time is you're maximizing how well they talk to each other, too. So that's a really good way to make sure you're getting the best performance out of that system. But as mentioned, that does increase the price because you're adding two pieces of equipment instead of just one. I'll skip the boiler section. There's another option, which is going all electric here. Now, in this case, it's removing the furnace entirely. Instead, you're using the heat pump for as much of the year as possible, and you have electric resistance heat that kicks on and boosts how much heat is coming to your house when it gets really cold outside. So the benefit of this type of system is it has the highest emissions reductions over time. However, it does get costly. Just using pure electricity all winter long, it does get more expensive with this all-electric system. And it also becomes very important to make sure you have quite an energy-efficient house to make sure you can, you know, have the benefits of this system. All right, so this is a lot of technobabble here. I just want to double check here. How are we doing in the room? Any questions come up so far? All right. So what pre-work might your house need? I said it earlier on, I want to say again, weatherization. This means insulation and air sealing. Very, very important with heat pump because it's just, I mean, it's a good idea to do this anyways. Again, if you live in an older house, you know, one built before 1980, built before 1960, there may be opportunities to add insulation to your attic, add insulation to your walls. Not only is that going to guarantee you energy savings, that's going to cut how much energy loss you have to the outside, improves your comfort, dampens the outdoor noise, protects against ice dams, lots and lots of benefits for making sure that you have good insulation and air sealing in your home. So if you haven't done it yet, if you live in an older house, highly recommend taking a look at that. Also on the service panel side, now the good news is that when it comes to service panel capacity, if you have a central air conditioner, you're going to have enough capacity. Who here has central AC? Okay. Fantastic. You all have enough capacity. Now, I do have to give a caveat to that this stuff gets very complicated. It's possible you might need some work in the service panel, but that tends to be rare. If you are able to successfully run an air conditioner, you should be able to successfully run a heat pump. All right, cost and bill implications. Who here heats with natural gas currently? Okay, natural gas, gotcha. So what we have here are the results of some of our energy modeling tools that we have that take the rates of electricity and the rates of natural gas, that's kind of averaged over 3-year time, uses weather data over the past 3 years, and then takes the specifications for how equipment actually behaves. There's a lot of calculations go behind this particular chart. Now, this is an estimate of what a typical home in Minnesota is going to be paying for heating and cooling throughout the year. Now, if you have a traditional furnace and AC, that's usually typical house, about $1,300 a year is spent between heating and cooling. Now, with Conexus Energy, I do believe you have what is called a dual fuel electric rate available. Is anyone on a dual fuel electric rate? Well, I suppose if you don't have a heat pump yet.
Is that off-peak?
It's a little different from off-peak, but yeah, it's kind of in the same vein of like a special kind of electric rate. So a dual fuel electric rate is when you have the option to switch between electricity and gas to provide your heating. And as an incentive for that, because it's basically letting the utility be able to manage their load more effectively, they offer you a lower rate. So if you have a dual fuel electric rate, you can actually run a heat pump down to 15 degrees, pretty cold, and still come out ahead on heating and cooling bills compared to that traditional setup. So that's pretty good. And unfortunately, I don't know why this little box is sitting there in the corner of the screen, but what you'll see is that switching the furnace at 35 degrees or so, you come out basically cost neutral on heating and cooling bills compared to the traditional setup. The all-electric system is quite a bit more expensive. That bar goes, you know, an extra handful of hundreds. So nobody here heats with propane, but just an example of how the type of fuel you have really impacts how the cost savings work out. Propane is expensive to heat with, quite expensive to heat with. So basically, if you can have a heat pump that takes any amount of the heating off of a propane-based system, and if you've got a cabin, perhaps this is more, you know, this is something that you're perhaps paying for part of the time. Basically, electrifying any of your heating with a heat pump compared to just heating with a propane furnace, you're going to come out ahead. Very strong energy savings with propane, but. Anyone here an XL Energy customer? Easy. Okay, let's talk about some of the incentives. So, this little box in the corner is going to kill me for this, but I'll try my best to describe it. Yeah, yeah. So we've got two things that are available right now. You've got utility rebates, like Gretchen described, and you've got tax credits. That stack of dollar bills over there on the left, that's showing what is going to be building up over time. Now, these are not all available yet. Right now is just utility rebates and tax credits. Now, the 25C tax credit, this is saying you can take 30% of the project costs up to $2,000 away from your tax liability for installing a high-efficiency heat pump. Generally speaking, if a heat pump qualifies for the 25C tax credit, it's going to be a higher-efficiency kind of unit. This credit resets yearly, too, so if you were to install other high-efficiency electric equipment the next year, you could also tap into this particular 25C tax credit. And it's also non-refundable, so if you don't have a federal tax burden, it doesn't pay, you know, you don't get a check for the remainder of it. It just eliminates how much you owe. The current utility rebates, Connexus is up to $630 rebate for ducted systems. Again, that's systems where we have a furnace. There's different tiers. If you have a lower performing system that you install, it's a lesser amount. If you have a higher performing system you install, it goes up to that full amount. And don't worry about the mini splits. Again, unless you've got a cabin in the area, mini splits, that is another name for those ductless systems. Now, what's going to be happening January 1st, 2024? Two things, or one thing is going to really change. Increased utility rebates. The 25C tax credit is going to remain. Now, if there was an XL Energy, if this was an XL Energy crowd, the good news about that is they're actually pretty dramatically increasing the rebate, up to $2,000 for a heat pump for XL Energy. Connexus Energy, we don't know yet. They have yet to announce what their plans are going to be for heat pump rebates. But I will say that you're seeing a lot of utilities that are thinking about stacking additional incentives on top of what's coming up. Later in 2024, that's when some of the big stuff is coming down the pipeline. The Inflation Reduction Act has significant incentives for people to install heat pump systems. The trick is, they got to get it set up. There's going to be different income tiers for these rebates here. It's going to be some complicated stuff. It's up to the state Department of Commerce to figure out how to implement this. They're currently hiring staff for it. This is all to say that it's a big system they're setting up here. And so we're all just kind of waiting on our hands, hoping that they come out with stuff. But it's going to be available sometime in 2024. I will believe that's going to have kind of a pot of money, and they will continue until that is out or they renew it. Now, this is how it looks like here. Now, the big one is the home electrification and appliance rebate. Apologies for all these titles here. Now, this is the big one. It's up to $8,000 rebate. So we talked earlier about how, you know, XL Energy up to $2,000, big deal. Now, this is up to $8,000, huge deal. This is broken into different income categories, though. For households that are below 80% of the area median income, 100% of that $8,000 is available. For households that are in that middle income, between 80% area median income and 150% area median income, up to half of that, so up to $4,000 is available for that. There's another pot of money that's also available. People can choose one or the other. The home efficiency rebates, that one applies for people that are, they get an energy audit, which determines how much energy they could save by switching to a heat pump. They install the heat pump and you get a certain amount of money back. That one has the most details to figure out because that one is the most complicated. You're trying to project how much someone's going to be saving energy with a new system. So the most applicable one is probably going to be this top one, the home electrification and appliance rebate, and is probably also the one you may have heard about because of the size of it. Now, the state of Minnesota this past year also passed legislation to provide another heat pump incentive. This stacks with the federal incentive. So it's a maximum grant of $4,000, and it's basically tied to the Inflation Reduction Act discount. If you get a rebate from the Inflation Reduction Act, the state will say, great, we can also pitch in money on top of that. So you need to have an energy audit for it. They require that you have the necessary insulation upgrades. Again, if your house doesn't have much wall insulation, doesn't have much attic insulation, they want you to take care of that first. And also, of course, just following the recommendations of the contractor. This is going to be timed to go live after the Inflation Reduction Act rebates have gone live. So there's a lot of stuff that's coming down the pipeline. What are we waiting to learn? The big one that everybody wants to know is when are these things going to go live? Because these rebates are not retroactive. That's the big bummer. These rebates are not retroactive. So we're all waiting for, well, when are they active? Because if you can't get a rebate for a heat pump installation before this point, you know, when are we trying to think about installing one? Fortunately, we do not know that today. We're also waiting to see what the area median income definition and verification process is going to look like. There are some ways you can calculate, like census, you know, IRS, have different calculators online to calculate area median income, but we haven't heard yet what official tool they're going to be using. We're waiting to hear about specifications too, and also for that complicated one I talked about, we're waiting to hear how they're going to model energy savings. So like I said, some of the new and expanded opportunities here. This is something, again, to keep your eye on. So some utilities are going to be upgrading their rebate amounts again. The federal government's going to be adding those heat pump rebates. In terms of timing of things, here's our general recommendation. If you know your furnace is on its last leg, your AC is on its last leg, we wouldn't recommend that you wait around for it to break and then try to find a heat pump replacement for it. That tends to be a stressful time. You tend to just get whatever they have on the truck that day. So if you know that you're looking at some equipment failure in the near future, we would recommend looking at, you know, considering a heat pump at that point as a potential replacement. What we're going to see is probably some pent-up demand, and so when the rebates finally do go live, it's likely that the contractors who install these systems are going to be backed out for quite a while. You might see some equipment shortages for a period of time. Basically, the market's going to have to adjust to this new influx of rebates for heat pump systems. So if that's something where you don't want to wait around for something, or if you don't like the idea of having prices move around on you, perhaps exploring a heat pump option before this point might make more sense. But for waiting for things, we're talking into 2024 or something. Again, they will be significant sources of support. All right. There's going to be some loan options that are also available. Many contractors offer their own financing products. Center for Energy and Environment, we administer some loans on behalf of MHFA. There are a couple options there as well. And next steps here to start wrapping things up. The first thing that we always recommend to people who are interested in making their home more energy efficient, they're interested in installing this, you know, equipment that is greener, that is more sustainable, is first start with a home energy squad. Has anyone had a home energy squad visit here? Terrific. Okay. Paul, if I may, could you describe the home energy squad visit that you had?
Well, they come in, they check the airflow, check your insulation and do infrared checks on losses through the walls and so on.
Perfect. Thank you. So for those of you who are online, Paul was describing how they check your insulation, they do an infrared camera scan of your house, check your heating systems, they do a blower door test, it's called. So there's a lot of stuff that gives you some really good quality information about how energy efficient your house is and what may be some opportunities to make energy efficiency improvements on your house. Thanks for letting me put you on the spot. So this is a good first step for just getting to know more about your home as a system, seeing what opportunities there are out available. And it also helps get you connected with, you know, some of these programs that are out there that just make it easier, you know, the process of finding a contractor easier, the process of accessing, you know, different resources easier. It helps to kind of move that pipeline along. Also, we recommend taking a look at what's called our preferred contractor network. So one of the things that our Minnesota Air Source Heat Pump Collaborative program has done is do a lot of outreach with different HVAC contractors. And HVAC contractors who are interested in heat pump technology complete our training courses, supply documentation, and licensure, can join the preferred contractor network. So this is a really good place to get a few quotes from if you're interested in what a heat pump system could look like in your particular home. So it's preferred contractor networks, a good place to start your search if you're considering a heat pump system for your house. And that is the presentation.